Verse 16, that Imam Abdul Rahman bin Abi Hatim rahmahullahu ta'ala records from the belief of his father Imam Abu Hatim al-Razi, and his father's sahib Imam Abu Zur'at al-Razi is وَالْبَعْثُ مِنْ بَعْدِ الْمَوْتِ حَقٌّ, and the resurrection after death is true. The fact that mankind will be resurrected, human beings, us who are responsible for our deeds, will be resurrected after we have died, this is a point of truth, something which the Kuffar of Quraysh denied. The Kuffar of Quraysh said that this is the only life we live here, as we read from Surah An-Najm, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ لَيُسَمُّونَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ تَسْمِيَةَ الْأُنْثَى. Those who they disbelieve in the Akhirah, they have no concept of Haya after death, no concept of Al-Ba'ath بعد الموت, no concept of being raised up after death, then these people, they will term the angels, the Malaika, with feminine names. So the Kuffar of Quraysh, they disbelieved in life after death. However, this belief, it is an essential part of the belief of a Muslim. That a Muslim's belief cannot be complete except by this point. As we mentioned many times, all of us, we know the hadith of Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam was asked by him, tell me what is Iman, an tu'mina billahi wa malaikati wa kutubihi wa rusulihi wal yawmil akhir, the last day, and in some wordings, wal ba'ath ba'd al maut, and that you be raised up after you have died. And a disbeliever may raise an objection that how can a person be resurrected after they have died? This is something which no person has experienced. No person has visualized that a person is raised up after they have died, after their heart has stopped beating. Then no person has ever been seen to be raised up and they've been given life again after they have died. Hence why this is from the beliefs of Al-Ghaybiyyat, of the unseen, that no person has ever experienced, no person has ever witnessed, no person has ever visualized. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives us a very logical and a very natural explanation of this. For example, in Surah Al-Hadid, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains, اِعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُحْيِي الْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. Then know, have knowledge, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives life to this earth after it has died. After this earth has died, after all the vegetation, after all the greenery has withered away in the winter time, then when springtime comes again, everything comes back to life again. Everything is as if it is resurrected again. The shoots, they come out of the ground. The trees, their leaves come forth once again and they begin to bear fruits again. After that same earth was barren, after it had died, after there was nothing left on it, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings it back to life again. قَدْ بَيَّنَّا لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. Certainly we have detailed for you, explained for you our signs in order that you may use your brains, in order you may use your intellect. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. That the same way the earth has been given life after it has died, then the same way you will be given life after you have died. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions life after death, that the same way He gives life to this earth, after it has died, after everything has withered away, then mankind will also be given life after their death. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives again a beautiful example toward the end of Surah Yasin. The end of Surah Yasin, many Muslims, they memorize Surah Yasin when they begin to memorize. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a beautiful visualization and a picture how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives life, how Allah subhanahu brings out life from non-life. And the ending of Surah Yasin, Imam Tabri rahmahullah ta'ala, Imam Ibn Kathir rahmahullah, Imam Ibn many a'imah of tafsir, they bring the hadith of Sayyidina Abdullah bin Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. Where Al-'As ibn Wa'il, Al-'As ibn Wa'il As-Sahmi, the father of Sayyidina Amr ibn Al-'As, the grandfather of Sayyidina Abdullah bin Amr ibn Al-'As, he approached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallama with a bone that was crumbling to pieces. A bone that was crumbling to pieces. He brought it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And he said, Ya Muhammad, أيحيي الله هذا بعدما أرى؟ أو محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give life to this once again after it has decayed, after it has become depleted, after it is in this condition where it is crumbling away? Will Allah Dhul Jalal give life to this once again? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the ending of Surah Yasin, where Allah Dhul Jalal mentions, وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقًا. And he brought forth a parable to us. He set forth a parable for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَيُحْيِي اللَّهُ هَذَا بَعْدَمَا أَرَى. وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقًا. And he forgot about his own creation. He forgot that before he existed, he was Adam. He was nothing. There was no he did not have existence before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him life, and Allah Jalla brought him into existence. وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقًا قَالَ مَنْ يُحْيِي الْعِظَامَ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ. Exactly how Al-As ibn Wa'il did. Who will give life to these bones after they have depleted? قُلْ يُحْيِيهَا الَّذِي أَنْشَأَهَا أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ. Say, the one who brought them into being in the first instance, the one who gave them life first, he is the one who will give it life a second time again. وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ خَلْقٍ عَلِيمٌ. And he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is all knowing over all of his creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he gave existence, gave life the first time, then why can he not give life a second time? And that would be easier, ahwan, upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After a person has made something, then it's easier for them to make a copy of that same thing. So once Allah has already given life to his creation, then it is easier for Allah Dhul Jalal to give life to his creation after he has caused them to die. الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّنَ الشَّجَرِ الْأَخْضَرِ نَارًا. The one who created, or he made from the greenness of the tree, fire. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention this? Because Allah Dhul Jalal, he's given an example that the same way that the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he creates fire from something which is a piece of wood, something which used to be a green tree, then that is, it's almost as if they are two opposites to one another. From a piece of wood and another piece of wood, a piece of tree and another piece of tree, then when a person makes a fire from those two dry substances, from those two pieces of wood and of tree, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes something else out of it, fire, nar, out of two things which are opposing, one wood and fire. They cannot exist, wood cannot exist when there is fire. The fire will consume the wood. But from that same wood, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala initiates fire from it. Because that is from the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. His affair is whenever he intends anything to come into being, he says be and it becomes. That is the affair easy for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّنَ الشَّجَرِ الْأَخْضَرِ نَارًا فَإِذَا أَنْتُم مِّنْهُ تُوْقِدُونَ. أَوَلَيْسَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ بِقَادِرٍ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَخْلُقَ مِثْلَهُمْ. Is the one whom created the heavens and the earth, is he not able to create similar to that when he has already created all of this? Then to make it again is easier for Allah Dhul Jalali wal Ikram. Bala wa huwa al-khallaq al-alim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains it so easy for us how he will give life after he has caused everything to die, the same way he made it all in the first place. The same way Allah Dhul Jalali wal Ikram initiated life in the beginning, then to create life once again is easy upon Allah Dhul Jalali wal Ikram. So وَالْبَعْثُ مِنْ بَعْدِ الْمَوْتِ حَقٌّ. Resurrection, belief in resurrection after death is the truth from the belief of a mu'min, of a believer. So the next point, point number 17, they mentioned وَأَهْلُ الْكَبَائِرِ فِي مَشِيئَةِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. And from the belief of Ahlul Sunnah, Ahlul Hadith, is that the Ahlul Kabair, the people who incurred major sins, they are fi mashi'ati Allahi azza wa jal. They are under the will of Allahu azza wa jalla. So this mas'ala, which we'll spend the rest of our lesson today upon, the previous mas'ala was pretty easy to deal with. أهل الكبائر, the people of major sins, those who in this life they performed such deeds, such actions which were among al-kabair, among the major sins, then what is their fate? The belief of Ahlul Sunnah is they are under the mashi'ah of Allah subhanahu. They are under the will of Allah dhul jalali wal ikram. Sins, ma'asi, dhunub, sayyi'at, they are categorized into two categorizations. Kabair and saghair. Major dhunub, major sinning against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and minor sins, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alludes to. For example, in Surah An-Nisa, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ. If you avoid the major of what you have been forbidden away from, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ. If you avoid in this life the major things that Allah subhanahu has forbidden you away from, نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا, then we will erase from you, omit from you your sins, your minor sins, and we will enter you into abode of honor, into al-jannah. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions al-kabair, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِر. Allah mentions major sins, meaning that not all sins are the same. Some are kabair and some are not kabair, meaning some are sagair, some are minor. وَيَجْزِيَ الَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا بِالْحُسْنَى الَّذِينَ يَجْتَنِبُونَ كَبَائِرَ الْإِثْمِ. Those who they avoid the major of the sins. So then the question arises in our minds that Allah subhanahu has mentioned these kabair. So what are these kabair? What makes a sin, what makes a dhamb, a ma'asiyah, what includes it among the kabair, among the major sins? What differentiates it from the sagair, from being among the smaller of the sins, the minor of the sins? Because not all sins are the same. You cannot compare somebody who, for example, they stole 10 pounds. Somebody who stole 10 pounds, is that a sin or is it a good deed? It's a sin. You cannot compare this sin equated to a mass murderer. There's a world of a difference between the two. So not all ma'asi are the same, not all sins are the same. Some are kabair, some are sagair. So there's a great ikhtilaf between the imma. What constitutes a major sin? What constitutes that which is kabair? Some of the ulama went to the opinion as to what is found in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. The hadith of Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, اجتنبوا السبع الموبقات. Avoid the seven destructive sins. So they said that these destructive sins, the mubiqat, which the Prophet described as being seven, these are kabair, and the rest of the sins are sagair. Some of the Sayyidina Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he was of the opinion that بل هي إلى السبعين أقرب. Rather, these major sins, they are closer to being 70 in number as opposed to being 7. But what we find to be the closest of all aqwal to that which is sawab, to that which is the truth, is that there is no set number of kabair. There is no set number of kabair, of major sins. Rather, they are biwasfin. The kabair sins are by a description. And what is that description? Anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and anything that his Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, they have threatened with an uquba, with a punishment. Or they have threatened with a la'an, a curse from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or they have any had upon them in this life, any capital punishment in this life. Or that person has been removed away from the rahmah of Allah subhanahu. Allah mentioned that he is far from my rahmah. Or any sin which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned specifically that they will receive a punishment in the akhirah or punishment in this dunya. Then these sins, they are among the kabair. These sins which are described like this, Allah subhanahu has promised the one, or threatened rather, the one who performs these sins with la'an, with ib'ad anir rahmah, with azabun aleem, with azabun muheen, with any had upon them, then these sins are kabair. These sins are the major sins. And anything beside this, then they are among the sagair. They are among the minor sins. So the major sins, they cannot be You cannot give them a specific number. You cannot give them a specific amount of how many they are. Rather, they fall under this description and this categorization, then they are the kaba'ir sins. And the minor sins, تُكَفِّرُهَا الصَّلَاةُ وَالصِّيَامُ وَالصَّدَقَةُ. Then by good deeds, إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتُ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتُ. Then by the good deeds you perform, by fasting, by praying, by giving in charity, by dhikr and adhkar, then these minor sins, they are wiped out. The major sins are those which require specific tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, the eating of riba, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threatens with harb, with war from him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Zina, uququl walidain, for example, these are among the kaba'ir. So these people who they perform these major sins, these sins that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threatened with, these kaba'ir, then what is their fate? What is their hal? What is the hukum upon them, the ruling upon them in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Al-murtakibul kabira. Some of the khawarij, for example, the khawarij said that this person who is murtakibul kabira, who they have incurred a major sin, while they had iman, while they were a believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you incurred a major sin with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the state of kufr, then innal islama yahdimu ma kana qablahu. Islam, once a person accepts Islam, then that Islam demolishes all sins that preceded it. But once a person, they believe la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, then if they incur any of the kaba'ir, then the khawarij, for example, they remove them from the da'irah of Islam. They removed them from the fold of Islam. And they said that if they die while having performed this major sin, then they are khalidun mukhalladun finnar. They will remain forever and ever in the fire of Jahannam. Why? Because this person now, if they die in that state, they have, because remember when we spoke about iman, the definition of iman, then with the khawarij, iman was shay'un jamid. With the khawarij, iman was one affair, was one block. If a person commits any sin, then they have removed themselves from iman. So they have gone into kufr and they are no longer a mu'min. Hence why if a Muslim performs any kabira, then the khawarij said that they are khalidun mukhalladun finnar. They will remain forever in the fire of Jahannam. They have removed themselves from Islam. Hence why, for example, in the time of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, all that fitna occurred because of these khawarij and these bughat. When they removed Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu from Islam, they said, you are no longer Amirul Mu'mineen, you are Amirul Kafirin. You are Amirul Kafirin. Why? Because you agreed to this tahkim. You agree to this tahkim, to this judgment with Sayyidina Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, with Sayyidina Amr bin Aas, Sayyidina Mughira bin Shu'ba, Sayyidina Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. You agreed to making the men your judge in the affair, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ. You have made mukhalafa of the Quran, you have incurred this major sin. Why? Because Allah says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ كافرون. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that these people are kafirun. Oh, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, you now become Amirul Kafirin, because Allah says, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. So you have removed yourself from iman, hence why all this fitna occurred because of these khawarij. Because they saw that now he is no longer a mu'min, he has removed himself from iman, he is khalidun mukhalladun finnar. Na'udhu billahi min thalik. So the khawarij said, anybody who commits a major sin, then they are out of Islam. They have removed themselves from iman. You had, for example, the Mu'tazila. The Mu'tazila, who they said, somebody who commits a major sin, a kabira from the kaba'ir, then he is no longer a mu'min. But he is not a kafir. He is not a mu'min. Now he is fi manzila bayna al-manzilatayn. He is in one stage, between the two stages, he is in limbo. We cannot say he is a mu'min, we cannot say he is a kafir. He is in limbo, in a stage between the two stages. The Murji'a, for example, on the complete opposite side, the Murji'a said, no, anybody who commits a major sin, and they commit major sins day in, day out, they are kamilul iman. Then their iman is perfect, and they're the highest level of iman, like Jibra'il, like Mika'il, like Israfil, like Musa, Isa, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Because to the Murji'a, amal has no connection to iman. So then iman is just تصديق بالقلب. A person to believe in their heart, لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله بس. They can do whatever they like, then they will be من أهل الجنة قاطبة. They will be from the people of paradise without any doubt. 100% they are from the أهل الجنة. Whether they commit major sins, whether they commit no sin, it makes no difference to them. And أهل السنة والجماعة, we are in the middle. We are in the middle. We are أهل الوسط. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. أهل السنة, أهل الحديث, أهل الآثار. Always we are in the middle. These people, the Khawarij took this طرف, this edge of the dalail, of the adilla, of the evidences from the Quran Sunnah, and the Murji'ah took from this طرف, this edge of the adilla and the barahin from the kitab and the sunnah, and ahlus sunnah joined between all of them. You cannot take, otherwise you'll become like those people who say, you know, Allah says don't pray, wala taqrabu as-salah. Allah says in the Quran, do not go near to praying, wala taqrabu as-salah, wa antum sukara, while you are drunk, then do not pray. But these people know, la taqrabu as-salah, do not come near to prayer. So this is not the way you interact with the adilla. You not take one half of one edge of something and ignore everything else. No, rather you have to take everything into consideration, all of the ayat and all of the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Ahlus sunnah, we are in the middle in regards to a murtakibul kabira, somebody who is a somebody who incurred a major sin in their life, and they acted upon this sin against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this person who is a mu'min, who is a believer in Allah Azul Jalal, because he committed this sin, we do not remove him from the label of iman, that now his iman has gone to zero. No, we do not say he has left Islam. Rather we say he is naqisul iman, he is deficient in his iman. His iman has decreased and it has become low because of his kabira, because of his major sin. And a person will, if they keep committing these major sins, then iman will keep going lower and lower and lower and lower, until at some particular point it will be completely gone from them. And we use as evidence, for example, all of the ahadith we spoke previously about shafa'ah. All of those ahadith about shafa'ah we mentioned previously in a previous halaqa, then they give evidence to the fact that a murtakibul kabira, he is not khalidun mukhalladun fi an-nar. Otherwise, how will the anbiya alayhi salatu was salam, how will the angels alayhi salatu was salam, how will the salihun, how will they make shafa'a in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remove these people from the fire of Jahannam? How? If they are removed from iman, if they are kuffar, then they will have to be khalidina fiha abada, remaining therein forever. But the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed for these people to be removed from the fire of Jahannam shows that they are not kuffar. They are not removed from the label of iman. Or they are still mu'mineen. They are still believers, but their iman is decreased and their iman is deficient. Hence why the Khawarij and the Mu'tazila, they denied shafa'ah. They made inkar of all of the ahadith of shafa'ah, of Sayyidina Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, of Sayyidina Abu Huraira, of Sayyidina, of these Sahaba who they narrated the ahadith of shafa'ah in Bukhari and Muslim. In Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, they made inkar of all of those ahadith. Why? Because they conflicted with their madhab of aqidah. That anybody who commits murtakibul kabira, anybody who incurs a major sin, that they are khalidun mukhalladun finnar, hence why there can be no shafa'ah. There can be no intercession, because these people will never be allowed to exit the fire of Jahannam because they are murtakibul kabira. This what led them to make inkar of the ahadith of shafa'ah. And likewise, for example, how many times in the Quran Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forgives all of the sins. جَمِيعًا, all of them collectively, together, all of them Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forgives. So why can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not forgive شُرْبُ الْخَمْرِ? Why can He not forgive الزِّنَا? Why can He not forgive أَكِلُ الرِّبَا? He can. إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا. But he has threatened them with all of these with these punishments. Likewise, for example, Allah سبحانه وتعالى makes mention, إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. Allah سبحانه وتعالى, he will never ever forgive that a person associates partners with him أن يشرك به. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives whatever is below that to whomever he wishes. Whatever is below a shirk, below that is a zina, below that is shurbul khamr, below that is akilul riba, below that is uququl walidain, below that is all of these ma'asi, all of these sins, though they are kabair, they are adna and less than shirk billahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah Dhul Jalal mentioned that he forgives لِمَنْ يَشَاءَ, for whomever he wishes. Who is this for whomever he wishes? Wishes, as we discussed previously, وَأَنَّ أَهْلَ التَّوْحِيدِ يُخْرِجُونَ مِنَ النَّارِ بِالشَّفَاعَةِ حَقٌ. And that the people of Tawheed, people who had belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the oneness of Allah Dhul Jalal wal Ikram, they had iman in Tawheed, then these people, by the shafa'ah, they'll be removed from the fire of Jahannam. The prerequisite for the maghfir of these kaba'ir is the person has to be a muwahid. They have to have belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They cannot be a mushrik from among those people who are busy in ashirkiyat. No, they have to have iman and belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. La sharika lahu. If a person is murtakibul kabira, and they believe somebody else can forgive their sins besides Fulan, Wali Fulan can forgive their sins besides Allah subhanahu, then for this person, they have committed shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they believe that Fulan can give them children, and that is the sifa of Allah subhanahu, يَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَاثًا وَيَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ الذُّكُورِ. This is in their capability, that they have no chance of any shafa'ah, of any maghfirah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because their tawheed was polluted, their tawheed was contaminated, and that is what is required for this murtakibul kabira to be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our belief of Ahlul Sunnah, of Ahlul Hadith, is exactly as they have written, wa ahlul kaba'iri fi mashi'atillah. They are under the will and the wish of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah Dhul Jalal wishes, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive them. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes, then because of their sin, because of their ma'asiyah, because of their kabira, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can punish them in the fire of Jahannam because of that sin, because of that dhamb, because of that ma'asiyah. If he wants, insha'a afa anhu, wa insha'a ghafara lah. If Allah subhanahu wants, he can forgive them, wa insha'a adhaba. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants, Allah Dhul Jalal, he has the haqq that he can punish that person because of that sin. So a murtakibul kabira, somebody who commits a major sin, we do not say that they have left Islam, they have left iman. No, they are still a believer, but they are naqisul iman. They are deficient in their belief. We do not say that they are in a manzila bayn al manzilatayn, laysa bi mu'minin wa laysa bi kafirin, laysa huna wa laysa hunaka, mudhabdhabina bayn dhalika, la ilaha ula wa la ilaha ula. We don't say that they are in a stage between two stages. We cannot say they are a believer, we cannot say they are a kafir. No, rather they are believers. Ahlul kabair are believers, but they are under the will and the wish of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a person, they cannot just rely on this, have ittikal on this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he can forgive me, I am a mu'min, I am a muwahid. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is shadidul iqab. Allah subhanahu, he is severe in punishing. He is sari'ul hisab. He is swift in taking to account. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's punishment is not a joke. It's not something to make istihza of. No, rather be far away. Do not just relax that, no, I am a mu'min, I am a muwahid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive me. No, rather you must avoid all of these ma'asi, all of these kabair, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, none of us knows whom Allah Dhul Jalal will forgive and whom Allah Dhul Jalal will punish because of their ma'asi, because of their sins. أقول هذا ما عندي والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم بالصواب وعلم وتم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. Of course, a person has to make tawbah, of course.